On December 12, 2005, Eastford, Connecticut held a referendum to decide if their 130-year-old ban on alcohol sales should be lifted. The following morning, the results were clear. Eastford voters decided to allow the sale of beer and wine in restaurants, ending more than a century-old experiment with prohibition and leaving Bridgewater as the only remaining town in Connecticut where the sale of alcohol is banned. During the Roaring Twenties, Westport became famous as a haven for artists, writers, and celebrities. With easy transportation via train to and from New York and cheap land and ocean views, Westport became known for its lavish parties attended by the newly rich and wildly successful.
And by the mid-1920s, you've got a series of people living here. Van Wyck Brooks, the great theatrical critic. You've got Hendrik van Loon, who's writing his seminal works on American history and exploration. You have John Held, who is really the illustrator and caricaturist of the 1920s. Fitzgerald comes here largely because Maxwell Perkins lives up in New Canaan. Brings along friends like George G. Nathan, the great theater critic, and they begin to, in the summer of 1920, hang out here and party very, very, very hard.
F. Scott Fitzgerald, newly married to Zelda and still enjoying the success of his first novel, This Side of Paradise, arrived in Westport in the summer of 1920, after being thrown out of the Biltmore Hotel in New York City for dancing on tabletops, doing handstands in a hotel lobby, and undressing in a theater.
They rent a very, very old house. It's one of the oldest houses in Westport. It still exists today. There's a plaque in front of it. And The Beautiful and Damned, the book he wrote while he was here, features lengthy passages about the consumption of alcohol.
Another Westport resident famous for his lavish parties was John Held, Jr.
There is no other artist, there is no other caricaturist or illustrator that captures the 1920s like John Held Jr. did.
He was well known as an illustrator for The New Yorker, Life, and other popular magazines of the 1920s. And his image of the Held girl came to define the Jazz Age and its youth culture.
John Held Jr. was so captivated by Zelda Fitzgerald that she becomes the prototype of the flapper.
As a very young girl, Lucia Neble White summered in Westport.
Well, the women whose husbands were artists really got dressed up to go to parties. They sometimes would wear a long dress, and they had a short haircut because that was in style then. And some of them smoked, and they all looked very elegant. My dad said they used to go down to Rose O'Neill's house, who was designed the Cupid doll, and she used to have a lot of parties there. And they all would get dressed up, and Rose O'Neill would walk around in these Isadora Duncan robes, and she was very beautiful.
Fitzgerald's neighbor, Frederick Lewis, a well-known millionaire and philanthropist, owned the Longshore Estate and hosted perhaps the most extravagant parties in the area.
Frederick E. Lewis was so wealthy, he could lure Houdini to come and escape out of a box dipped into Long Island Sound.
For those not on the guest list, speakeasies were readily available.
If it was a restaurant at the time, in the 1920s, it also served as a speakeasy.
While the Miramar nightclub, later the Penguin, was a well-known speakeasy frequented by out-of-town movie people and known for its jazz bands, the artists and writers of Westport favored the Compo Inn, run by Marion and Jake Levy.
Guy Pendebois, the ultimate quote, "Work was an effort made between parties." It's the great quote of a hard partying generation that has come through the first great Holocaust in world history, World War I. They're back, they're young, and they want to party.
From the very beginning, the state of Connecticut resisted prohibition. Newspapers spoke out against the amendment, and citizens often treated it more like the local laws they had lived under since the mid-1870s. Those areas of the state that supported the law enforced it. Those that didn't let violations pass without incident.
Any individual could buy as much as he or she could afford and store. Now, who could do that? The wealthy. Who had the money to buy it and the place to store it?
On the final days before Prohibition, restaurants and liquor stores reported brisk business.
In Manhattan, the Yale Club had enough liquor that lasted, turns out it lasted them all 14 years of Prohibition. They never went dry for not a drop.
The roots of the Prohibition movement can be traced to a small northwestern town in Connecticut. It all began in 1789. When a group of 200 farmers in Litchfield agreed not to use distilled liquors while doing farm work.
And they do it because, in fact, alcohol is becoming a problem for their workers. It's getting in the way of getting their work done, getting the farms ready.
Little did they know that their actions were the precursor to one of the greatest social experiments in our history. It was the end of the American Revolution. Connecticut had been torn up by the war.
Out of wedlock births were skyrocketing. Unemployment was very high because we were about farmed out. People were leaving the state in droves. And of course, in the middle of all that disruption, there was a lot of drinking. It was used for medicine, it was used for socializing, it was just part of what you drank at the table. But in the wake of all this social confusion, all this distress, people began drinking much more.
The peak, or the nadir, depending on your perspective, of American drinking was in 1830, when the average American over 15 years of age drank the equivalent of 7.3 gallons of pure alcohol a year, which is to say 90-fifths of 80-proof liquor, 1.8 bottles of liquor a week per person. And if you consider that a lot of people didn't drink at all, those who were drinking were really, really drinking.
When Lyman Beecher, the father of Harriet Beecher Stowe, arrived in Litchfield in 1813, the town was ready to hear his messages of immorality.
Very quickly, it became clear to him that a lot of vice, a lot of immorality, a lot of the terrible tragedies he would see in his parish came not from bad instincts necessarily, but from bad practices, from people drinking too much.
His sermons on the evils of drinking caught fire, spreading throughout Connecticut and nationwide. Around the same time, another well-known Connecticut native began to call for temperance, P.T. Barnum. Known as the world's greatest showman, P.T. Barnum created what later became known as the Ringling Brothers and Barnum and Bailey Circus.
As his popularity grew and grew, his exposure to different levels of society broadened, and he found himself being elevated in American society, but also in Europe. He was touring with Tom Thumb throughout England, Spain, Germany, France, and he was engaging the Queen. Queen Victoria at that time, crown heads of state, where there was enormous amount of opportunity to enjoy wine and champagne. On one trip home, he realized that his behavior was becoming more argumentative and more problematic, not just to his personal deportment, but to his business, and certainly to his family. He recounts in his autobiography that he gets up in the middle of the night, goes down to his wine cellar, and cuts the heads off 60 or 70 bottles of wine and dumps them onto the ground. And from that moment, he becomes one of the greatest champions and public voices for the temperance efforts throughout the country and even into Canada.
We want the right to know what's in our food.
The early temperance movement is credited with pioneering many techniques that are now commonly used among social activists and community organizers.
In particular, print. They were the first people to come together and create propaganda materials in the United States. Sunday school tracts, pamphlets, stories from reformed drunkards that then they distributed en masse in Connecticut and then across the country. They were also among the very first to organize lay people, ordinary citizens, to start campaigning in their localities for laws that would somehow either suppress or regulate the liquor traffic. Probably their best technique, the technique that got people most excited and really spread the word, was the temperance meeting. And what they would do is stand in front of the audience and whip the audience up with their tragic stories of the results of drinking and their heavenly visions of the rewards of abstinence until the audience was in a frenzy of feeling, and then they would climax by inviting members of the audience to come up and sign the pledge at the front of the room that declared that they would drink no more.
It was entertainment and politics all rolled up in one. And it became a movement that inspired almost all of the other reform movements that came in the 19th century.
The people who were the big promoters of temperance were usually the most progressive. They were the ones building the schools, building the hospitals, working on behalf of the poor and other marginalized groups. And these ideas led directly to many of the greatest reform movements of the 19th century.
Including the women's movement.
At that time, women were not really allowed to speak in public. They were expected to be private people. Any public business they had to do would be done through their fathers, through their husbands. What the temperance movement did was invite women to come be publicly active.
They wrote letters. They organized. They worked to persuade their husbands and their neighbors, one by one, to stop drinking.
The consequence of extreme male drinking was really awful for the family and for the entire social context. The husband would go to the saloon, he'd get smashed, he'd drink away the mortgage money. He'd get so smashed he couldn't make it to work the next day. He'd get so smashed he'd come home and he'd beat his wife and children. Women in the middle of the 19th century had no legal rights at all. As a consequence, in fact, the Women's Christian Temperance Union, which became this 250,000 member army of incredible effectiveness in the last quarter of the 19th century, they called themselves a home protection movement. That was the idea of getting rid of liquor, to protect the home and family life.
It really is their first taste, in some cases, of having some power, having something to say to the public, and then not being able to, because social convention was keeping them away from that.
In the late 1800s, Connecticut's population was changing. It was one of the top states for industrial production, and factory work attracted large numbers of European immigrants. Danbury had the hat trade. Vernon and Manchester had textiles. Waterbury had brass. In Hartford alone, the population increased 50% in just 10 years. Causing a strain on local resources and dramatically increasing the demand for housing, food, and basic necessities.
Well, home life in the tenement districts was pretty crowded. There's not a lot of space in any of the apartments, and there are a lot of children.
Saloons lined the streets leading up to the factories and offered an escape from poor living conditions, as well as a free lunch.
You could help yourself to cheap, salty, filling food, fried potatoes, beef stew. They'd have crackers and cheese and some sausages and things that don't cost them a lot of money and are likely to make you thirsty for a second beer, which is where they make their money. You could get your mail addressed there if you were in the process of moving or between housing if you're really poor. You could buy stamps, buy cigars, and they were also public bathrooms.
And the saloons ranged from very elegant places, but more likely they were really run down, really vile pits of hell, as some of the early prohibitionists called them.
Many of the new immigrants came from Ireland and Germany, cultures that held social drinking in high regard.
There's not only a class tension there, but there's a cultural tension. that you have people coming in who are not Protestant, who are, many of them not even Christian. They interact with each other in different ways in the street. They're louder. They seem to be more inclined to drink. And for people who have been in the city for a couple centuries, whose families have been in the city, this seems like things are getting out of control.
Like most of the immigrants of the time, Lucia White's mother experienced this tension firsthand.
When she lived in New York City, she used to go downtown to do her shopping in the Italian section. And when she came back one day, she said to my father, "You know, I thought this was a free country." She said, "Nobody likes the Irish here. Nobody likes the Italians. Nobody likes the Negroes, and nobody likes the Jews." She said, "You know, I don't think I'm going to like this too much."
In 1851, Maine enacted the first statewide ban on alcohol in the country.
A large portion of the population, particularly Irish immigrants, felt it was a law enacted to punish them because beer was a central part of the working man's life.
Connecticut experimented briefly with a Maine law of its own, but had more success enacting a local option law.
The local option allowed each town or voting district to vote whether they would allow the sale of alcohol in that town or district. This allowed the towns that had a high percentage of prohibition supporters to outlaw liquor, while the larger cities were kept happy because they would always vote to allow the sale.
In Hartford, a block about one quarter square mile was reported to have 83 saloons, or one saloon for every 11 and a third voters. The Temperance Journal, Connecticut Home, claimed that there were more saloons in Connecticut than in Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi, South Carolina, and Florida combined. Connecticut's changing demographics continued to play an important role in how our state viewed alcohol consumption. National temperance organizations like the Crusaders, the Woman's Christian Temperance Union, and others seemed to have little success in Connecticut. There was often poor attendance and lack of money to sustain the organizations. However, in other parts of the country, the temperance movement was growing. One of the most famous prohibitionists of the time was Carrie Nation.
I described her as having the biceps of a longshoreman, the face of a prison warden, and the persistence of a toothache. She was 6 feet tall. She believed that she was speaking to God directly. She ran along God's side, she said, as a terrier nipping at the heels of dissolution and drunkenness. And she began her campaign in Kansas, destroying bars.
Nation was known for marching into saloons and attacking the bar with a hatchet. When Nation was asked to speak at Yale, she posed for this picture. When the lights went out to make the flash work, college pranksters brought out steins, cigarettes, and whiskey glasses. The now famous photo still hangs on the wall at Maury's in New Haven.
I think the most important moment you could say in the early history of what became Prohibition was the formation of the Anti-Saloon League in Oberlin, Ohio in 1893.
Founded by Protestant, native-born, white clergymen from the middle of the country, the Anti-Saloon League saw themselves losing the country to the immigrant hordes taking over the cities of the East.
The Anti-Saloon League decided they were going to use political influence, not marching in the street, not praying in the bars, not bringing hatchets into the saloons, but political influence to change the laws.
Members of the Anti-Saloon League became important advocates for the passage of a federal income tax.
What does the income tax have to do with drinking? Well, it's very clear if you stop to think about it. Until the ratification of the income tax amendment in 1913, until then, as much as 40% of the federal government's domestic revenue came from the excise tax on alcohol. The stamps on every bottle and on every keg that indicated a tax had been paid on it. Now, you could not have prohibition and deprive the government of 40% of its internal revenue. And then in 1913, along comes the income tax. And it's at that moment that the Anti-Saloon League, meeting in their offices in the Bliss Building across the street from the Capitol, all their lobbyists gathered around a table, all their leaders gathered around a table and said, now we can have a constitutional amendment. The government is no longer running on the fumes of liquor.
In Europe, the outbreak of World War I was causing increased hostility towards all things German, including beer.
What were the brewers' last names? They were Anheuser and Busch and Pabst and Schlitz and Müller and Rupert. They were all German, and it was very easy for the ASL to paint them as the enemies of the American Republic.
The Anti-Saloon League, quick to spot an opportunity, lobbied Congress for a wartime prohibition, which forbid the brewing of any beer stronger than 2.75% alcohol, arguing that the grain needed to brew the beer was needed overseas as rations for the troops. They were successful, and the Wartime Prohibition Act was passed. Though these arguments worked on a national level, Connecticut was not ready to take the leap to prohibition. Just 2 years prior, in the fall of 1917, Judge Bacon Wakeman of Fairfield asked residents to vote to make the town dry in an effort to preserve resources for the war. Wakeman's plea fell on deaf ears. Fairfield voted to remain a wet town. With so many of Connecticut's citizens living in an urban environment, temperance and prohibition had little meaning. To the largely Catholic working class male, the issue continued to be one of local control. In 1917, the Anti-Saloon League won its biggest victory yet, getting an amendment to the federal constitution to clear through Congress.
So you had 48 states in the whole country at that point, 1919, so you needed 36 states. And February of 1919, 36 states had already adopted the amendment. But the dries, the people that favored prohibition, that wasn't good enough for them because this was a cause. They wanted to be able to turn to Europe and say, every state has voted this through.
Many prominent Connecticut residents spoke against the amendment, including former President William Howard Taft, who at the time was a professor at Yale. He wrote, "I am opposed to national prohibition. I think it is a mixing of the national government in a matter that should be one of local settlement. We shall thus hang a permanent millstone around our necks." When the issue came before Connecticut's state Senate, there was vigorous debate. But when smoke cleared, the vote was 20-14. Connecticut's Senate became the first political body in the country to vote against prohibition.
And it was carried all over in the newspapers, the Washington Post, New York Times, The Current, of course, headlines, "Connecticut stops the prohibition movement."
In the end, Rhode Island became the only other state unwilling to ratify the 18th Amendment.
Well, what did Connecticut and Rhode Island have in common? Connecticut's population in 1920 was 67% Catholic. It was a Protestant movement, it was an anti-Catholic movement, and it was never particularly popular either.
And Connecticut became the symbol whenever there was a debate again as things went downhill for prohibition. Mid-20s and late 20s, they always said, well, Connecticut is the one that led the way. Connecticut knew at the time that it was a bad idea.
The amendment is enacted in 1919 to become effective a year later in 1920. That was to give the brewers, the distillers, and the vintners time to switch to another industry. It also gave people time to stock up. Those who were well off were able to provide. Those who were not well off had to find other means of getting it. And it's before prohibition takes effect that you begin to find people beginning to set up bootlegging networks.
One of Connecticut's most celebrated scofflaws was Nellie Green, a brawny, tough-talking, colorful woman. As a child, Nellie's father taught her boxing and made her believe that girls could do anything that boys could do. As a teen, she learned to sing opera and performed publicly. However, it was her entrepreneurial skills, developed later in life, that led to her real fame and fortune. With the advent of Prohibition, Nellie saw the ban on alcohol as a business opportunity, and the next 12 years became the most lucrative of her life. Most people assumed that national prohibition would use the same 2.75% standard that wartime prohibition was using. No one predicted that Andrew Volstead's bill, which used the Internal Revenue Service standard of 0.5% alcohol, would pass in Congress. On October 28, 1919, it did just that. And overnight, a new underground market for stronger spirits was created.
She thought that Mr. Volstead was the goose that laid the golden egg for people in these parts. They made plenty of money because of that. She wasn't for it in the beginning, but it was lucrative for her afterwards.
For most of her career, Nellie Green carried on a legitimate family business as an innkeeper along the Farm River on the Brantford-East Haven line. She built the Talmadge Hotel on her family's property. The 20-bedroom inn had a dining room that sat 300, a dance hall, bar, and large kitchen. But when Prohibition was enacted, Nellie quickly understood that her customers had no intention of obeying the 18th Amendment, and that a profit could be made by making available, in her words, the stuff the government had no right taking away in the first place. The Volstead Act did allow the possession of alcohol for private use, spawning the birth of private clubs known as speakeasies. The Talmadge Hotel served as an ideal location for such a club. However, Nellie's real profits came from acting as the middleman, or in this case, woman, storing cases of rye, rum, whiskey, and gin brought up on the Farm River and stored behind fake walls at the hotel until the cases could be picked up by their rightful owner.
She handled all the money, all the transactions, and they would pay her for storage. $5 a case. And later on, she was making runs for different people, and she'd get in her cars with her driver, and the trucks would follow her through Connecticut to the Massachusetts line. And for that, she got $2,500 for each trip.
Eventually, she bought her own boats so that she could buy directly from the suppliers, occasionally picking up a partner who would advance her as much as $50,000. For Nellie and many of the folks that ran in her circle, the game and how they played it was as important as the money they made.
Strong men of weeping, dry throats cry out in anguish as the stern and relentless gentlemen under Deputy Prohibition Administrator Amon carry on in a scene of frightful destruction.
On the law enforcement side, there were challenges from the beginning. Many Connecticut residents considered enforcement of the 18th Amendment a federal problem.
Well, it's a good lesson. The law must be obeyed, and garages should only have automobiles.
Some towns chose not to use their police force. Others simply did not have the resources to combat illegal liquor sales. Towns like Fairfield, with only 3 unpaid constables, were in no way prepared to deal with the onslaught of crime that Prohibition brought to the community.
There were not a lot of police departments in existence. The major cities in the state, the city of Bridgeport, the city of Hartford, New Haven, they had organized, uniformed police departments going back to the late 1800s. In the rural areas, there were elected constables and sheriffs. And when they drove down the street, or they walked down the road, or they rode their horse through a meadow or something like that, were waving to everybody in that town. They knew everybody back then.
Which made arrests for alcohol violations more challenging. When police were unwilling or unable to stem liquor traffic, some public officials took matters into their own hands. In November of 1926, the mayor of Norwalk went over the heads of the Norwalk Police Department and ordered the state police to conduct several raids in the city. 16 arrests were made, including the arrest of Edward Splann, a constable. The local paper blasted the Norwalk police. These should be incidental matters, but a police department loses its greatest value if it cannot be trusted to clean up conditions of vice. If Mayor Robbins brought about these raids by state officials and had to go to the state officials to do it instead of using his own force, it is high time for a showdown and a little interior renovating there. During Prohibition, many Connecticut businesses were forced to diversify or close their doors. Both the Aetna Brewing Company and the New England Brewing Company decided to manufacture near beer, or beer without alcohol. Many saloons were converted into tea rooms, soda shops, or restaurants, or they closed altogether. The Hublines, Hartford hotel owners credited with selling the world's first pre-mixed cocktails, survived Prohibition thanks to their small but growing side business of producing A1 steak sauce. The Volstead Act, much to the delight of New Englanders, permitted the manufacture of non-intoxicating ciders for home use. Cider making had been in the Alderman family for nearly a century before Len Alderman's grandfather built a modern mill in 1910.
At that time, hard cider had about 6% alcoholic content. It was about the same thing as beer. But unfortunately, it was illegal to make beer. But you didn't make hard cider. Nature did.
State police raided the Alderman family's cider mill in 1923, seizing 40,000 gallons of hard cider. But the charges were later dropped.
They said it's not our fault if it turned to the hard cider, because it was sweet cider and we made it.
Most immigrants drank beer, you know, something they brought from their own countries. Some drank wine, the Italians, of course, made their own, but most of the farmers all drank hard cider. It was just fruit juice.
When Prohibition came along, Jack's grandparents prospered selling vinegar.
Instead of slaving away out here, you could make 20 barrels and come out of it with probably $4,000, which was a lot of money in those days, you know? And not as much work, really.
Getting alcohol in Connecticut during Prohibition was clearly not a problem. Our proximity to the water and the Boston Post Road provided a convenient bootlegging artery between New York City and New England. The problem was catching the bootleggers. And that responsibility rested largely on the already overburdened shoulders of the Treasury Department.
Why the Treasury Department? Because before Prohibition, if you were chasing after moonshiners who weren't paying their tax, it was the Treasury agent, the revenuer, as it's called in the comic strips of the time, who would come and arrest you because you were not paying taxes. Now, the Prohibition agents who did the enforcement on land, they were paid the modern equivalent of about $25,000 a year. And whenever there was a vacancy, there were 1,000 applicants for the job because that was really a ticket to make several hundred thousand dollars a year because the bribe money was so clearly available.
In the first 6 years of Prohibition, one out of 12 agents were fired for taking bribes or other corrupt acts. And even the honest agents found it hard to police the state. The federal government assigned only 13 agents to Connecticut, one agent for every 106,000 people in the state. The newly formed state police force, chartered in part to address widespread liquor law violations, offered some help, but they were woefully under-equipped for the task.
Technology was low. The cars all looked alike. They were all the same horsepower. The roads were mainly dirt. Troopers were often finding themselves digging out of ruts. People complained because they didn't know the difference between a state trooper's vehicle or a state police officer's vehicle and anybody else's vehicle, that the commissioner and the superintendent ordered all the roofs removed from the vehicles, and they had to drive around in convertible cars basically year-round.
Much of Connecticut's illegal liquor supply came from the sea, so the Coast Guard was responsible for enforcing prohibition laws along the shoreline. However, the Coast Guard was created in 1915 and was only 5 years old when Prohibition began.
Prohibition was thrust on them. They weren't really prepared. They didn't have the assets, they didn't have the people, and they didn't have desire to enforce Prohibition.
Ships from all over the world would anchor legally in international waters, 3 miles off the coastline.
Where the U.S. Coast Guard or anyone else could not enforce U.S. laws.
And then inshore rum runners, where the phrase comes from, would get in their speedboats. They would go out, they would pick up shipments, and then deliver them up and down the Connecticut coast.
This line of ships, anchored bow to stern, became known as Rum Row.
And they'd pretty much have blackboards, and they'd put up how much their liquor was, with scotch, $15 for a case. And you could actually go shopping along Rum Row and pick what you wanted. I want some rye, I want some scotch, I want gin. This guy's giving me a better price, I'll take that one. A lot of the rum runners never broke the law. They'd buy a schooner in Canada, they'd register in Canada, they would go pick up a load in the Bahamas, take it up off Montauk or take it up off, you know, Fisher's Island even, and stay outside the 3 mile limit, offload their booze, and head back to Bahamas.
There was a saying, you could make more by turning your head for a half hour than you could make in half a year.
A good rum runner could fill a schooner with about 5,000 cases, and he could clear $100,000 on a trip. This is 1922, 23 dollars, 100,000.
From 1921 to 1924, export of scotch, which sold from as little as $8 a case in its home port, could fetch as much as $65 a case on Rum Row. The land price for that same case of scotch doubled to $120. Bootleggers would then take over, cutting each bottle, adding grain alcohol and distilled water. These doctored bottles brought in as much as $400 a case.
The closer you were to the coast, anywhere in the U.S., the more likely you were able to get decent quality liquor, usually shipped from the U.K. to the Bahamas, and sometimes Bermuda, and then run up the coast and dropped off at, you know, you could deliver 30,000 cases at a time.
Eventually, the 3 mile limit was extended to 12 miles, but that only made it more challenging for the undermanned Coast Guard.
A lot of people say that Prohibition was the first government fishing subsidy program because the money, amount of money that was made on the waterfront by just regular folk being able to transport liquor, paid mortgages, sent kids to college, it was quite significant.
One of Connecticut's biggest rum runners was Campbell Augie Strusholm. A decorated veteran of World War I and son of a fierce temperance supporter, Campbell Strusholm became one of Connecticut's most successful liquor importers of the time.
Campbell was very upset when he came back from the war and realized that there was no liquor to drink because it wasn't fair to die in war and not be able to drink.
After trying his hand at car sales, Campbell decided there was more money and adventure to be had rum running.
Besides not agreeing with the law, people went into it thinking that they were going to become famous and plus become millionaires.
Married to Margaret Emmeline Lindbergh, daughter of the well-known hotel entrepreneurs Margaret and Otto Lindbergh, Campbell set up his rum running operation in Old Saybrook.
At the marina, he had all his very fast boats, and this was a perfect place to keep them because it was great for navigation. It was at the mouth of the Connecticut River. He could get out, go out into Long Island Sound, pick up booze, and bring it back.
Alcohol waiting for delivery would be stored at his in-laws' hotel, Ye Castle Inn, or more commonly known today as the Castle at Cornfield Point.
People came and they stayed. There was a lot going on all the time. They had bands and they had gambling, and of course they had lots of liquor flowing here and there.
As a savvy businesswoman, Margaret Lindbergh knew she could not run a successful inn and entertain her guests properly without serving alcohol. Campbell Strusholm became her supplier.
There were places to hide the liquor at the castle in false walls and big closets and things. And my grandmother did not believe in the prohibition, you know. She was feisty. At one point when she was taken in, she said something to the effect like, well, how can I run an inn with guests like this without having any liquor?
At the beginning, like most rum runners, Campbell's fleet of boats easily outran the Coast Guard.
The Black Duck is probably the most famous boat, and that had two Liberty aircraft engines in it, and it was outfitted to outrun the Coast Guard.
Campbell's business thrived with the help of a community.
The people in Saybrook were outraged when Prohibition went into effect, so everyone was very happy to be part of that and to move the booze and to get the booze.
He had a lot of people that were local, that were fishermen, that were more than willing to help him out.
People in the community would tip him off when a raid was planned, and local fishermen would willingly help smuggle alcohol from Montauk Point and Rum Row. Eventually, Campbell used his own ship to import booze from Canada and the Bahamas.
He would run to Canada and bring back liquor on a huge sloop that he actually sailed on, you know, looking like a leisure yacht.
Campbell supplied much of the Connecticut coastline with its liquor. Customers like the Gelston House in East Haddam would receive shipments either by boat or truck.
He always wore a bulletproof vest when he went out.
As time went on, the Coast Guard became faster, and the business became more dangerous. Violence and organized crime rose, forcing law enforcement agencies to spend more time and money policing the land and waterways. New London became home to the biggest concentration of anti-smuggling ships in the history of the United States. By 1925, the Coast Guard had doubled in size, and a training station, which eventually became the U.S. Coast Guard Academy, was established.
They built smaller boats to patrol inland waters, a medium-sized boat to patrol waters maybe out to 3 miles, and then they got much larger boats, even destroyers from the Navy, that they used as a show of force out in international waters.
But the Coast Guard was hampered not only by some of its own personnel taking bribes, but by outside forces. With public sympathy high, it became increasingly difficult to prosecute rum runners in the courts. One federal judge made a conviction virtually impossible despite the completeness or nature of the evidence. It became so problematic for the Coast Guard that at one point they actually issued orders to bring captured rum runners into other ports, if possible, to avoid falling under a particular judge's jurisdiction. One rum runner, known as Blackie, was quoted, "We respected them. You know, as I look back, I realize that if they hadn't been a bit on the friendly side, they could have put us out of business at any time had they really set their minds on it. We were enemies at sea and damned good friends ashore. Many's the meal I had aboard a Coast Guarder with the skipper and his crew, who may have been shooting at us the night before."
By the end of Prohibition, the Coast Guard was able to stop rum running, but in the meantime, it had become so sophisticated and organized crime had become so organized that the Coast Guard was powerless to really fight organized crime.
As the decade wore on, Connecticut and New Jersey were labeled the two wettest states in the Union.
People really want something badly. They will find a way to get it.
Connecticut residents found loopholes in the Volstead Act helpful.
You could bring grapes into your house and you could press them and drink them for your own consumption, for your own family, and you were allowed 200 gallons a year. That's a big family. It was said that in certain Italian neighborhoods, in October, during the pressing season, if you walk through the neighborhood, you could get drunk from it inhaling.
Under the Volstead Act, you were allowed to obtain alcohol legally for medicinal and sacramental uses. In Connecticut, one might be led to believe that a religious revival took place during Prohibition. In 1930, more than 26,000 gallons of wine were used for sacramental purposes. It also appeared that an epidemic of illness had struck Connecticut at the same time as citizens were experiencing their religious revival.
It was very common across the country for you to go to your physician and get a prescription for alcohol. They would usually charge about $3 for it. You'd trot it down to the local drugstore, and you would get a pint of liquor. You could get it every 10 days. Charles Walgreen had 20 drugstores in 1920. He had 525 in 1930. A Charles Walgreen Jr. acknowledged that they were in the liquor business. The official line was that they grew because of the popularity of the malted milkshake, but there was something else to it as well.
Bell Island, located off the coast of Norwalk in historic Rowayton, was as charming in the 20s as today. Adjacent to Long Island Sound, surrounded by hidden inlets and tidal marshes, and populated with the rich and famous on summer holiday, Bell Island became a popular area for bootleggers. This quaint island's origins, however, were strictly dry. In the late 1800s, this seaside community grew, benefiting from the oyster, fishing, and lobster industries.
But it was a working class and middle class community with a few wealthy homes here, but most of the people were hardworking people. And I think a lot of them were actually supporters of the idea of prohibition. Not all of them, but there was a temperance group that formed here and in fact was operated out of a little store that still exists today. And a number of prominent citizens were members of this little temperance group.
Recognizing its resort potential, two brothers from Danbury, Joel and Timothy Foster, purchased Bell Island in 1881 and developed it into a popular summer destination for Connecticut residents escaping the nearby cities. The Foster brothers had no tolerance for drinkers. In the sales deeds, they included the phrase, "No spirituous and intoxicating liquors or any distilled liquors, ale, lager beer, wine, cider, or fermented liquors of any kind shall be sold or kept for sale. Breach of this condition shall forfeit the estate."
And there were several incidences where that happened, where they took back the property from the new owners because they discovered that they were either selling liquor or holding events that could be qualified as public drinking fest.
The social life of the island centered around the Bell Island Club, where guests enjoyed swimming, tennis, card parties, theatrical performances, and dances. A nearby amusement park, Roten Point, added to the summer festivities.
They would take steamboats from New York City, from Bridgeport, from Long Island to come to this amusement park for a day's outing, a break from their hard-working days.
By the time the Roaring Twenties arrived, the Foster brothers were no longer around, and for some, the island's social life improved.
Bell Island became a huge party place. And it was the summer home of many Hollywood producers and directors and actors and well-known people like Burt Lahr came there for the weekends, they came for the summer, and it became this hotbed of fun and alcohol and dancing and just good times. At the end of the summer, there would be this enormous party and a conga line would form and it would go all around the island. And as you reveled your way through the island, each house you would stop and dip your cup into a large pot and drink, and then go on to the next house.
A New York newspaper called Bell Island a bootlegger's paradise where case after case of spirituous liquor could be found.
Rowayton is full of little marshes and creeks, and so for bootleggers, it was heaven because you could bring your boat in all sorts of locations, and it was almost impossible for the government to keep up with all the little nooks and crannies along the way. The government did everything they could to stop this partying, and they apparently used old battleships from World War I and would cruise the waters of Long Island Sound with huge spotlights. And all during the night, these spotlights would sweep over Bell Island. And as one man told me at the age of 95, as a little boy, you couldn't sleep because these lights shone on your house all night long.
The Coast Guard boats were no match for the bootleggers' speed and the residents' ingenuity. One home even had a hooch hatch built in its floor for the sole purpose of receiving deliveries of alcohol in the dead of night. The feds weren't entirely unsuccessful. One of the biggest busts occurred just across the harbor from Bell Island on Wilson Point.
There was one big catch that was made in Wilson Cove, which is in Norwalk, just on the Rowayton border, where apparently $100,000 worth of French liquor was discovered in a railroad car. The New Haven Railroad ran through there, and one of the conductors noticed something dripping from underneath the car, and when he went to check, it turned out it was alcohol. And I still wonder if the Foster brothers weren't rolling over wherever they were at the fact that this place that they had set up as this pure, alcohol-free summer community turned into this party place.
It was clear that Prohibition was failing across the country. For every illegal still, bootlegging ring, or rum runner that had been stopped, captured, or destroyed, many more were willing to take the risk for financial gain and to keep the thirsty citizens of Connecticut swimming in liquor.
In 1927, the Connecticut Department of Labor issued a formal statement that said Connecticut industries have great renown, great reputation throughout the nation, and even its bootlegging industry is known for better quality product at more reasonable prices than bootleggers are able to provide in the rest of the nation. That is virtually a direct quote from an official document of the state of Connecticut. And so it tells you sort of what was the attitude toward Prohibition in Connecticut in 1927.
With a flawed system in place, many people saw that the only way to fix Prohibition was to repeal it. The stock market crash of 1929 and the depression that followed ensured that it was only a matter of time before Prohibition ended. No two citizens of Connecticut better exemplified the opinion of the majority of residents during the demise of Prohibition than Governors John Trumbull and Wilbur Cross. Both men made it clear that they wanted to see federal prohibition end and full liquor control returned to the states. In a referendum, 85% of Connecticut citizens voted in favor of repeal, the highest percentage of any state. Ironically, the population that was so instrumental in Prohibition's passing was also crucial to its repeal: women. In 1921, after a long battle, women got the vote. They were now politically active and had legal power outside the home. The suffrage amendment had laid dynamite under the Prohibition Amendment.
One of my heroes from this period is Pauline Morton Sabin, an incredible woman who was an heiress to the Morton Salt fortune. She was married to a J.P. Morgan partner. She was the founder of the Women's National Republican Club. She was the first woman member of the Republican National Committee. She believed in Prohibition until she saw how it wasn't working and how, in fact, how its deleterious effect on the American population, particularly on her children. She saw that they didn't take law seriously because here was a law embedded in the Constitution that wasn't being enforced. So why should they take any law seriously?
Rowayton resident Wendell Livingston is Pauline Morton Sabin's great-granddaughter.
She was upset about the hypocrisy of the whole situation, the fact that people who were mandating the laws and were arresting people were, in fact, privately drinking themselves. She was very concerned about the fact that it was turning private citizens, law-abiding citizens, into criminals. She began to reach out to her friends, and her friends were women of influence and social standing, et cetera, around the United States, and said, we need to do something about this, because I know you feel as I do.
So she, in 1928, goes over the wall. She becomes the leader, the founder of something called the Women's Organization for National Prohibition Reform, which seeks to repeal Prohibition. And until then, it wasn't respectable, except in the big cities in the Northeast, it wasn't respectable to be against Prohibition. But this woman was so respectable. And when she and her friends, Mrs. Rhinelander Mrs. Cortland and Mrs. Van Rensselaer, literally these names, went on a tour of the South in 1930 and 31, the Junior League women, the debutantes in each of these cities, would come out to hear them, and it became okay for them to be for Prohibition.
In March of 1930, a group of prominent Connecticut women, led by Mrs. Lucius F. Robinson, Jr., formed a state chapter of the Women's Organization for National Prohibition Reform, or WONPR, and began recruiting members across the state to join their organization. On January 28, 1932, all three Connecticut reform groups, women from the WONPR, the Crusaders, and the Association Against the Prohibition Amendment, gathered at a rally at the Bushnell Memorial Hall to hear Governor Wilbur Cross and Pauline Morton Sabin speak. By June of 1932, 29,000 Connecticut women had joined the movement.
And the stock market crashes in 1929, and the Depression follows, and unemployment skyrockets, and industrial production plummets, tax revenues begin to disappear. The federal government is collecting 33% less income tax than it had been before. There's no capital gains tax collected at all. Nobody had capital gains between 1929 and 1933. The government is running on fumes. There are bread lines. There are people living in the streets. The government doesn't have the money to do its fundamental basic operations, much less spend anything to relieve the economic circumstances.
Proponents of repeal claimed that $40 million was being spent annually on enforcement of the 18th Amendment, all while the federal government was missing out on more than $800 million in revenue from taxes on the legal sale of liquor.
I am not unmindful of the great blessing which the abolition of the saloon has been to our country, or of certain other benefits that have resulted from the adoption of the 18th Amendment. It is my profound conviction, however, that these benefits, important and far-reaching as they are more than outweighed by the evils that have developed and flourished since its adoption.
Not only does there become a sudden groundswell of support for repeal to get the tax dollars back, but it's also an employment program. The distilling and brewing industries, pre-prohibition, together were the fifth largest industry in America in terms of invested capital, and nearly so in an employment. Suddenly, you bring it back, and you are putting tens of thousands of people to work, not just in the breweries and the distilleries, but the drivers, the cork makers, the bottle makers, the farmers who are harvesting the corn that you need to make bourbon. Suddenly, you have an employment program.
I, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, do solemnly swear.
When Roosevelt had been elected, my father said, "Thank God he's going to bring back beer." My father didn't care whether the railroads ran off the rails or not, but boy, you were going to be able to go down and buy a bottle of beer.
In February of 1933, Congress proposed the 21st Amendment to repeal prohibition. State after state quickly ratified the amendment. And by December of that year, it became official. When beer returned to Hartford, the Current reported that thousands gathered in restaurants, clubs, and hotels to drink. However, there were strings attached to this newfound freedom. In Connecticut, hotels were not permitted to sell beer without food, and there was a ban on perpendicular drinking. Standing and drinking a beer was not allowed. Patrons were required to sit at a table and be served. Grocers reported an unprecedented demand for pretzels, cheese, and tidbits.
How is society different? It had a real effect. It did alert people, I think, to the alcohol problem. It didn't solve the alcohol problem, but it did alert people to it.
By the end of 1933, the citizens of the wettest state in the Union could once again enjoy their beverage of choice legally. The temperance and prohibition movements proved to be complete failures in Connecticut. The land of steady habits had never ceased its habit of drinking liquor and could now, once again, do so free from the watchful eyes of temperance advocates and the law.
Brown man, what makes you brown man? Said a gal to her man, so miserable. You look so winning when you is grinning with all your gold